So our next speaker is Dr. Ganesh Shankar from FluxGen Technologies. And he's going to speak on IoT and data science for CleanTech.
Yeah, thank you very much. I should thank the director and especially Kushal for making all the arrangements and calling up and making sure that we are having a wonderful conference here. So this purpose of this presentation is mainly directed towards some of the students. As a businessman, I'm also looking for great human resource in my company. So, and considering the fact some of my organization already have people from ICER, so I know this is a great institute. So it's also a bit of talking about my own journey in entrepreneurship, and maybe in a way inspire students also to take up entrepreneurship through this little experiments that I did through last 10 years. So the outline is about how it all started, how I actually became what I am today, and to get a perspective on how do we get energy and water. Many times you consume it, but not really know what's the implication of it. And thanks that the previous speakers have already talked about climate crisis, so I would not talk about it much, and how the energy consumption, water consumption is interlinked to that. And how IoT and data science can be a potential, I mean, using IoT and data science, you can have a potential solution for the above thing. And I'll just talk about most of my talk would be about the case studies of the work that we have done. And I'll conclude hopefully something that's what a great philosopher has said. So I did go to as good institution as you are all in, like Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore. I did my master's there. I did actually work in a startup before doing my master's. So my master's was probably driven towards building commercial products very start itself. I had seen a startup back in 2005. And then I worked in this lab called Ion Trap Mass Spectrometer Lab under Professor A.G. Menon and Professor Atanu Mohanty were my guides. And then I got a job in General Electric. I worked on aviation systems and then in energy meters. At that point of time, I got I got into real interest in energy business. So I thought I should actually start a business. I tried micro experiments in entrepreneurship in my early days. So I really thought, and also working in a startup helped me make the decision to take out of the thing. I worked in a firm called Selco for a short duration to understand what clean tech is all about, or so sustainability is all about, eventually to make my own career vision in that direction. So I came to Bangalore and set up a solar plant in the rooftop of my house. And I just wanted to understand how it actually works. So I put up data acquisition equipment to it, and I saw the energy generation. I was not getting as much as I was promised. I mean, the solar panel told you would get for a 1 kilowatt peak panel, you would get 5 units of electricity. But I was not getting, or rather I was getting much lesser. Then when I put the data acquisition equipment, I could see that it's actually much lesser because there's a lot of shadow falling on the solar panel early in the morning and evening in the evening. So this really started helping me understand that if you're putting solar plant, you should be aware that you should be taking this data to understand, make a reasonable good decision. And thanks to my alma mater, Indian Institute of Science, seeing this, told, oh, we need this thing, what you have done in your lab. We want to monitor energy generation from a solar tracking system and a static system and see how much more you get. So we got the opportunity to set up the solar plant, and we were able to get data. So it's our earlier system. We had a big control panel, put energy meters. Since I have some energy meter background, I used the meters, didn't want to build anything on my own, used those, and use a computer to do acquisition, put up a software to run it. We could see that the energy generation obviously is different by a tracking system and a static system. I don't know whether you can see here. At around 8:30, you would see energy generated by tracking system twice as static system. So this started, this helped me. I mean, you can see the date is around 2012. So this set the foundation that yes, there is a need for monitoring this consumption and generation. And then I started, what should I be doing as a product? It took quite some time. So these were the questions that I also thought, how do we get energy and is it the most optimal way we get energy and water? So there's actually also a slide that I use as a presentation of my course in ISE, Data Science, IoT and Data Science, CleanTech and AgriTech. So I'm going a little fast on that front. So I ask this question to my students, and many times many people actually would not know how they actually get electricity. So incidentally, you get electricity from a very long, very far off place, and you have energy generation, whether it's thermal power plant or a nuclear power plant or hydroelectricity. Then there's a transformer that would enable you to step up and then step down, and eventually you get power. Likewise, water also goes through a lot of procedure, like you have a tank, especially a city like Bangalore, which had 400 to 500 lakes. Today we get water closely from 120 kilometers away, right? There's 120 kilometers away, and that water would come, and then you purify, pump it, and then put it at a height so that it would pump enough to come. In this process, so much of energy is utilized. So that is actually not, most of us are not aware. We get water at almost, as a resident, I would get at 10 rupees per kiloliter. But actual energy, cost to the BWSSB is around 89 to 90 rupees. So looking at this, at 2013, I thought something is wrong. It should not be this way. So, and it was during the same time, it occurred to me that these are all the indirect reasons why the climate crisis is happening. I would use the word climate catastrophe that is happening today. In the sense, the water that I waste today is indirectly related to energy wastage, and that would lead to emission. So energy consumption and water consumption, I could directly see that value. Same with agriculture. It would complicate the situation more. I'm happy Jitendra spoke about it. So I would say this is the truth. I really recommend all you students to read this book. I don't know if I kept it here. Climate Solution by Mrudula Ramesh. This is a great book. It at least is a good starting point to understand how really climate crisis is affecting us, right? So it eventually helped me understand that it's only the understanding is the water level in all the seas is going to increase. That's not it. It's much more than that. Because it's a warmer planet, the habitation, what happened years back, would actually have to shift. But that's not possible. We already invested so much in infrastructure. And because there's a higher temperature, it also leads to more diseases. Like malaria would be more because of a warmer planet. Of course, there's some countries may benefit out of warmer planet, but very few of them. I don't know who are those. So this was a problem statement. I'm sorry, I took too much time to set up the problem statement for you, that we have water crisis in our country today. We are not aware how much energy is getting wasted leading to climate crisis. So I really thought it is rather better that the generation and consumption should happen locally. This is when I just left my job in General Electric, and since I was in smart grid, I realized that so much energy is getting wasted, or even part of it is theft as well. And so you should rather be generating locally and consuming locally, producing and consuming locally. So this was my idea back then. Microgrid was like not any invention. It was there forever. Probably the first grid was probably a microgrid. So you generate electricity locally, various forms, and that's no-brainer. And you would also make sure that you collect water. It's very depressing that Bangalore had 500 lakes and today we have only a handful of lakes. So if you could actually harvest the water in your own home, you could actually distribute amongst this local network. So this, I thought, was a good potential solution to the world. There is challenges involved in it. For a big grid, you have a big setup, economics works well, economy of scale. When it's a small system, then you would not be able to employ a lot of people to do what it happens in a big grid. So then that's where probably technology comes into picture. Not like all these problems, whether it's power theft or periodic maintenance or failure in electricity generation or water storage not in adequate enough, or there is like some overload of power. You put a mixer or something that doesn't actually ensure the grid is stable. So there was definitely issues that came to my mind that, yes, this might be a little difficult to implement. But, well, there is technology, and we came up with an idea of how about using, it started with, to be honest, when we were initially doing this data monitoring on a pen drive and taking this data and then realized that rather than putting in a pen drive, we put it on internet, then suddenly people started calling us IoT company, and that's how I discovered we were an IoT company. And then we thought of how to use this technology further, collect this data and control this whole infrastructure through this data-driven mechanism for smaller bits, because you don't have, it's not a big scale where you could hire people to do things. So we came up with this IoT-based wireless sensor network and health monitoring and controller system for a smaller setup, and thought, okay, we would make it a completely smarter system by monitoring and doing this energy generation. So this is how a, what started as just setting up small plants for some university like this to actually coming up with an idea to set up microgrids came in our mind. So then we came up with further on how it would be developed, and we came up with a roadmap or product roadmap out of this to monitor meter and water flow, combine these two things and develop it. So, you know, when you're in 20s, you're a socialist. And in your 30s, when you see the hard, you become more of a capitalist. So my heart was very close to the villages. I mean, I thought whole of my education was public funded, whether going to a government school or to the University of Science. It's all your taxpayers' money. So I thought I should do something for the people. So we decided, let's electrify a village which had no electricity at all ever or no possibility. So we not only chose a village which was not electrified, the Supreme Court had made a clear this one, in reserve forest area, you should not extend electricity grid. It would lead to poaching and further other problems like fire, forest fire. So we chose this place called Mendil in Belgaum district of Karnataka, North Karnataka, where there's no electricity at all. I mean, not just electricity, it's wildlife and no medical facility. Transportation was also, I mean, absolutely out of question. So this is called Beamgard Wildlife Sanctuary. We went there, trekked there. I mean, in your 20s, you like to trek. I mean, you do a lot of adventurous stuff. So we went to this place. This is a village. You had to trek almost like 5-6 kilometers from that place. And there's no transportation, as I told you, you have to walk down there, and nearest city was some 60 kilometers or so. But beautiful place, absolutely beautiful. I mean, no go this one. This is a hamlet, they call it as Wada. It's close to Maharashtra, so they speak Marathi. So this place, we thought, let's electrify this place and give them electricity and see how we can use all this technology to. To our surprise, there was data connectivity, internet, but no electricity. So that's the story today, that we have access to internet, but many times not electricity. So that worked in our favor. So we, for any entrepreneur, first you have to do a baselining. You have to know what's current status. How do they get access to what you want to provide next? So we realized they use this chulas, this kerosene lamp. And they were actually using a small solar panel or this one, but that was not functioning. But they were actually taking this battery from a nearby truck. I mean, 5 kilometers, they used to charge it once and carry it, this 100 kg truck, this one, battery they used to carry all the way to this one, keep it running for 1 week and again take it back. So imagine. And on top of that, they had a inverter which had 30% efficiency. So they would hardly, even a 100 ampere hour battery would only give you 30 ampere hour. Or rather, because it has 50% discharge, you'd only get 15 ampere hour. So this was the state. So this was the baselining of how they would get access, get to electricity. So we did, like what is in in any startup, you actually want to understand your user. So we did talk to all the users, starting from the mukhyastha of the village to the people around. And the children, actually, students, children actually told me something that they want electricity because they wanted to study. They want to compete with the city people. I was like, oh God, I never wanted to do homeworks in my school. These guys, really. So, yes, and Divecha Center for Climate Change at the University of Science wanted to fund this project. They thought this is aligned to climate change mitigation. And this is also, in a way, help this villages get electricity. We did go through the village panchayat, Shirali panchayat, and permissions from all the government official to transport good inside the forest of place and put it. We also had a hurdle that we can't get any place to set up this plant because it's not allowed. So we had to take help from one of the villagers to get. And we did. We did actually put up the, started putting this electric grid there. So this is a solar plant that we put in the area of that thing. And we connected to the energy meters available in the market, started getting data out of it. Well, that's where I'm slowly coming to the data science part. So we were able to put up a weather station as well. And we were able to put electric sockets in a places. We didn't want to put 3-pin socket because we know the energy generation is hardly 2 kilowatt peak is the total solar plant. So you would only get maximum 10 units of electricity per day. So we put only 2-pin sockets so that they could use for lighting and this one. And this was our data acquisition equipment with some hardware, embedded hardware, and connected to our software. So we took, we had done a lot of development in the lab, because of which we could stay in that forest only for 3 days, and we were able to make it work. And this is the overall system. Oh, this is not weather station. This is weather station. We were able to put up a system to monitor through the smart monitoring system. And that girl could see electricity today, and she had never seen electricity. Especially ladies in the village had not gone outside that village. Of course, men used to work in nearby village, nearby cities like Panjim, but this girl is now going to college, actually. So I was also told the same year, the passing percentage in 10th increased by 70 to 80% more. So we got a feeling that how electricity access is so important in many various other this one. So not only that, they got television and they were able to get connected to the world that we live in and mobile phones. So in a way, giving access to electricity. So what was important in terms of research for this project? Because this was a pilot project to do more projects in the future. So we were able to get the energy generation curve and energy consumption curve on this. So you would see we would see that it is a very behavioral thing. On a day when there is very good sunlight, when the batteries were charged, they didn't even switch off the light and they slept. They were happy, this one. And we could see exactly at the time, there's a very good Kannada, a very popular Kannada TV serial. At that time, this would actually, the power generator, they would start switching on their television and everybody comes home. So we could start seeing many behavioral aspects through the energy consumption data. So on a day when there was not much sunlight, they were very conscious. This was sometime when they, you can see 2015, 16, they could see on a day when the they had seen if they totally use off the power when there was not much sunlight, they would not get it. So their behavior also changed after seeing that energy availability is this one. And we could see these are the times that they would actually consume the time, most of the power in the morning. So this eventually helped to come up with the right sizing of solar microgrids. Okay, the paper that we wrote, we presented in IEEE Smart Grid Conference in Miami and various other, and also various other places, this document helped in coming with the microgrid policy. So we did further analysis. The day when the energy generation is least, the consumption is most. So we had to put additional battery to back up this. So the whole system design got a new way of looking at it with data available from this system. And weather data also helped in understanding how you should probably have a mix of energy generation from solar and wind. So this was an interesting exercise. So the next case study I would like to go up is like, this was when, this is still 2015. I was just probably entered 30s, and then I realized that as an entrepreneur, I should also take care of my family. I was also married just then. So in fact, I still remember when I left my job in GE, my mother had told me, who's going to marry you? To the point that I got married to an extent that, then I realized, like, while my mission is to work on eco-friendly engineering solution, precisely what I had put in my resignation letter in GE, I should work on something related to water. So we got a project to optimize the water utilization in this facility. So we got to work with people who actually manufacture gold that is Tanishq, the Titan jewelry division, Tata company. So they were buying water at almost like 65 rupees per kiloliter, nearly $1 per kiloliter they were buying water. And every year the water consumption was regularly increasing. And they had only inlet of water, and they were measuring it, and they were taking hand readings from a bunch of places. They're no way aware that where the water is leaking, wasting, or excessive usage was happening. So they were not able to come up with any strategy. So they told, we want a digital system that would actually monitor. What have you done for this village? Do it for water. That was their interest. So you were able to monitor power coming consumption houses like that. We want water to be consumed, monitored. So we came up with this strategy of water, and we started putting this device. This is like a wireless sensor node that would monitor the water flow going to individual place in this facility. Like this, we put in 31 different location, 31 to 40. Today, we got a repeat order. We have actually put more than 60 to 70. So like this, and they told we can't give you any power, so we had to put solar. That was also another differentiator for us. We were aware of solar, so we could integrate solar with our IoT device. And we were able to monitor. We were able to monitor different places. You could see data coming from all these things. Suddenly, they were able to know how much water. I mean, before they used to go outside. I mean, to be honest, even today in many places, we have a very prehistoric way of managing water. You would have mechanical thing. People go out and check those data and then take manual intervention. Water wastage is actually not thought through at all. So we ended up building this software which would have all this data. And this is where we actually applied a little bit of data science, not very high end, because you don't require, for a facility which is so low tech, we just had to put simple analytics to find out where there is a wastage instantaneously, where there's a leakage. They were initially doing visual inspection to find out whether there's a wastage, leakage, or excessive usage. So this was a sudden shift in terms of water management. They were able to clearly get blinking lights on where that this one, and they would fix it in half an hour time. So in a way, getting this data to the local area network, to the cloud, you were able to find out. Eventually, this led us to identify each industry has its own way of consumption pattern. And using that, you can actually find out whether the consumption is valid or it's excessive. So this is how we ended up building our product. Okay, this is post 2016, we became a product company. And that was AquaGen, and fortunately, we did this like in 20 different facilities to manage water. And we were able to take water flow data and put it to the cloud. And we were able to, just like you have Ola and Uber for transportation, we were able to bring it for water. So the inflection point just happened last year for water management, because Chennai ran out of water, and that's when people had really realized that, yeah, water has to be monitored, and the amount of water is actually not as much as we think, like the oceans there, and with climate change and climate crisis, I think it's only going to shrink. I'm not a subject matter of this climate crisis, but I believe it is going to only shrink. So we developed this, and now we are able to identify, on top of that, we are able to identify data science layer into it to find out if it's a leakage, wastage, and identify different models for different industry. Like dairy is one of our biggest client base, and we are able to build training data set based on the operator use and identify during differentiate what kind of thing. Processes happen, clean-in process, bunch of processes. Using that, we were able to build a training data set to identify where there's leakage and wastage. To be honest, we are still developing in a much, ambitious way, but today we have more or something in between what you call as machine learning to analytics. So I would say still a lot to be done, so that's why I'm very interested in having some of you guys who have gone through this training to come and do internship with us if you can. So we developed the mobile app, so even the ground staff guys would be able to know where there's leakage. The plumber is now empowered with digital device to manage water in this facility. Also, thanks to Professor Bharadwaj and this one, we were able to do this at LCTA as well, the electronic city. So bunch of these facilities. So how much time I have? Over, is it? Okay. I'll just not take much of my time. I'll just tell you, the solar part I spinned off to a new company, which were able to identify similar losses in power generation through using IoT and data science. So we started with IoT, but we had a spectacular failure because the economics of monitoring solar panel, individual solar panel would not work, at least in Indian condition. But yeah, SolarEdge is able to do it at international scale. So we did some projects with the Vecha Center, and I spent off this as a company from my own classroom at Indiana of Science as a 14 weeks course at 14W Technologies. I'll be able to talk later about it. So we tried developing this monitoring, but that didn't work. So what actually, we came up with this user interface and everything and developed this thing. What actually worked was, instead of putting sensors in every panel, why don't you move the sensors around the whole solar farm? Because this data won't change, and the kind of level of defects happens over a long duration of time. So two of my colleagues from my company, FluxGen, actually became the co-founders of this company. And today we have scanned up to 6 gigawatt. And we have increased the profits by up to 20% more to these companies, which include SoftBank Energy, to Tata Solar, Acme, all these companies. We have been able to provide this service. Using data science, we are able to identify where there is faults in solar farm. There are a bunch of faults, I think like 20 to 30. By this training process, we are able to identify what that hotspot may mean. I mean, there is a, if you take a radiometric and thermal imaging from a drone, you get this kind of a thing. And you would know there is fault, but would that lead to energy loss? So that, with the help of IIT Bombay and professors in IIC, we actually took that help to actually build this technology. And so today, this is a paper I can share later on it. And yeah, so I really think there is a lot of scope for applying data science, IoT for clean tech. I mean, while there's spectacular technologies for entertainment and gaming, this is very important, like climate crisis or water, energy. So I would urge you guys to think about it. This field is open-ended, and you have opportunity in it. Think of doing your research, or even job, or even consider starting a company on this. Thank you so much. So you can reach out to me on this email ID. This is the quote I would leave with: by believing passionately in something that still doesn't exist, you created. Non-existent is whatever is not sufficiently desired. So this is a blog post. You can take this one, that you can know the greater this one, the story of the startup, which may help you do something on your own in this field. Thank you so much. Do you have time for questions?
Yeah, for sure. So thanks a lot. Very interesting and inspiring talk. And we have time for questions.
Yeah, thanks for the nice talk. So these days, supercapacitors are also coming up. Mm-hmm. So have you tried implementing those also with your IoT setups?
Yeah, incidentally, we worked with Professor A.K. Shukla, who was then Dean of Science at ISC. He had implemented a supercapacitor for... So these are supercapacitors. We actually built a company around it to give the solar lanterns. So yes, I think supercapacitor, the advantages is the reliability of the supercapacitor matches with the reliability of solar panel and LED light. So these three together become a powerful. So you would see a lot of supercapacitors coming in, but you know the charging and discharging cycle is not so comfortable for the current technology that we are already into. So it would play very important. We have tried it, but still long way to go.
Any more questions?
The water monitoring system that you are talking about, would that be appropriate for like an apartment complex? Maybe 10 apartments or so. Is that economically feasible for the apartment, cooperative to invest in this thing to identify whether they have significant water leakage?
Yeah. So actually, apartments are actually taking this water management. We have not been doing on that front. The thing is that a customer segment where the billing is very important factor than conservation. So today you are getting a water bill based on the size of your apartment, not based on the water consumption. So, and in apartment, you have multiple inlets because of which you have to put multiple devices. So this company called Smarter Homes is doing an excellent job on that front in managing water. I think Bhanu Prakash was just telling me that his apartment already has a solution from this one. So, but yes, they are coming up. But we are mostly focused on industries which consume more than 100 kiloliters of water. Yes.
Yeah. Okay, so any more? I have still option for a question because the next speaker is getting ready. Okay, so no more questions. So thanks a lot. Very, very nice talk.
Thanks so much.